There is a Gemara in Brachos, a Gemara in Daf Zayin. The Gemara is speaking about a Kadosh Baruch Hu and Bilam. And the Gemara says amazing things about both Hashem and about Bilam's understanding of the Ribbono Shel Olam. The Gemara speaks that a Kadosh Baruch Hu gets angry. And the Gemara asks, is there such a thing? Mi ikar rizka kadei kut shebrichu. Hashem's anger. The Gemara says, in. And the Tanya, the Gemara quotes a Braisa. The kale the zoy am bechol yom. Kadosh Baruch Hu gets angry daily. The kanazano. The Gemara says a rega, and the Gemara says how small that rega is, and the Gemara says ve'ein kolbiria. No one knows how to be mechavin osa shoa. No one knows when that moment is going to be. Chutz mebilam arasha. Only bilam arasha. The ksiv be the yodea das elyon. Says the Gemara. The pasuk says that bilam is yodea das elyon. Asks the Gemara. He doesn't know the das of his donkey. He knows the Das Elyon, says the Gemara, you're right. He doesn't really know Hashem, but he doesn't know one thing. He knows when a Kadosh Baruch Hu gets angry. And the pasuk, the Gemara goes on. V'haynu di'omelu hu Navi li'Yisrael. This is what is meant by the Navi, when the Navi says, Taftayr Pashas Bilam. Ami zechur na ma yo'atz Balak melech mayav. Remember what it was that Balak tried to do to you. Remember what Bilam tried to do with you. The pasuk continues on the under. Also Bilam ben Beor min Ashitim at a Gilgal man da sikas Hashem. You should always remember what Balak tried to do, what Bilam tried to do, in order that you should come to a true akara, a real understanding of the tzidkas, of the righteousness of a Kadosh Baruch Hu that a Kadosh Baruch Hu did not let them. And the Gemara explains, what does that mean, Laman Das Sitkas Hashem? It's Omer Rebbe Lazar, Omer Lehem HaKadosh Baruch Hu Yisrael. Hashem says to us, Du'u Kamet Sitkas Asisi Mokem, look and see how I treat you, how I act towards you, with righteousness, with Nimishur as I did. Shalei Ka'asti Dinei Bilam HaRasha, all during the time of Bilam trying to curse Klal Yisrael, I never got upset. Shel Noli Ka'asti, if I would have been upset that moment, Lo the shtayr v'soneim sheyisrael sekeplalim, you would have been destroyed. That's what it means. And the man das tikkas Hashem v'haynu degomer lebilam lebalak ma'ay koyv lekav akeo. What can I curse? HaKadosh Baruch Hu is not allowing me. Ma'ay zon is loizom Hashem melamed shekol osan ayomim loizom. Those days of bilam, HaKadosh Baruch Hu did not get angry. So it's an amazing Gemara. Gemara seems to be saying that we, Klal Yisrael, are demanded, we are commanded, is to be zocher, to remember, Laman das sikas Hashem, remember the righteousness of HaKadosh Baruch Hu. It's as if, so to speak, we're commanded in many things to remember. This is amongst them. We should not forget. So it seems to be the Gemara stressing that this is something, so to speak, crucial. So it's very important. And this anger of HaKadosh Baruch Hu daily. But during this time, Hashem did not allow himself to get angry. Hashem forgo, he transcended above that. So how do we understand the importance of this? What does it mean Hashem gets angry every day? Why is Hashem getting angry every day? What does that mean? What does it mean now after the sitkas of HaKadosh Baruch Hu for the sake of Klal Yisrael? HaKadosh Baruch Hu did not get angry. So how do we understand this well? The Gemara in Brachos, and there's another Gemara that deals also with the story of Pashas Balak, Pashas Bilam. And the Gemara over there says again an amazing thing. Amar Levavoh, the Gemara is in Brachas, Laf Yubesim and Beis. Amar Levavoh, Ben Zuch Rishiyom of Yehuda, Havazvida, Bikshu, Likvaya, Pashas Balak, Bekriyashma, would be the longest chakras, the longest marav in the world. You can imagine, Pashas Balak is going to be inserted into Kriyashma. That means Shema Yisrael, the Hayyim Shamaya are going to have an additional Pasha added to them. Yes, the Pasha of Balak, Pasha of Bilam, that belongs in Kriyashma. Umidnei lakavua, and we should tarek tzibur just too long. But otherwise they would have instituted it. So the Gemara says, if it's because they're psukim the deal with our being taken out of Mitzrayim, that we find many places in the Gemara, in Torah. So why is this unique? So the Gemara says, rather, there's a pasuk that says, Kama shachav kari, kelevi miya kinenu. When we lie like a lion. When we raise up like a lion. We sleep in peace. And Rashi explains, is Kama shachav didami l'shachbuchav kunecha. It's like kriyashma. L'shachbuchav kunecha. In our shchiva, in our kiva, in our resting, in our getting up. Shakarish bochu shemreinu b'shachveinu v'kumeinu. Shem guards us. Both as we rest, as we sleep, Like lions sleep peacefully, we can sleep peacefully. It's interesting that Parshas Balak in Kriya Shema had not been in it so long because of one pasuk of Shachbacha, of Kumecha, to be similar, that the way it was Sheikhet, like an Ari. It's interesting. Parshas Balak and Kriya Shema, what Sheikhets? Why in the world would anyone put Parshas Balak together with Parshas Kriya Shema? What is there in Parshas Balak that goes together with Parshas Kriya Shema? And the Pnei Yeshua, the great Acharon, Adav Yubesim and Besim, Sechtes Brochus, asks, it's funny, it's interesting, it's strange almost. It's in Kriya Shema. Kriya Shema is unique. It speaks about our relationship with our Kodesh Baruch in such a unique way. And why exactly the Parshas Bill Balak have a place in that? And the Pnei Yeshua says, Zechor Ami. It's to be Mekayim, that's Zechor Ami. Remember, Laman Da Sidkas Hashem. In order to be Mekayim, Laman Da Sidkas Hashem, Chazal would have put it into Kriya Shema. It's an amazing thought. Right? What exactly is about Parshas Balak, about Parshas Bilam, that's so unique that its place would be in Kriya Shema, that we're commanded Zohar Na? What exactly are we supposed to remember? How are we supposed to fulfill the Navi's Savod, the Navi's command, remember Lamanda Sidkas Hashem? This is what we'd like to speak about. HaKadosh Baruch Hu did not get angry. Lamanda Sidkas Hashem, that we should remember that righteousness, Chazal would put it in Kriya Shema. How do we understand this? What's the approach to this? Of the matanas that HaKadosh Baruch Hu gave to Klal Yisrael is the Ramchal. The Ramchal's Torah is very deep, very beautiful. And the Ramchal has a sefer that's called Das Tunos. And there's one underlying theme to understand the Hashkacha of HaKadosh Baruch Hu in this world. To understand the way HaKadosh Baruch Hu interacts with the world, and specifically with the Jewish people. And the Das Tunos presents that in the Hashkacha of HaKadosh Baruch Hu, with specifically Klal Yisrael, there are two hanhagas. There are two ways HaKadosh Baruch Hu deals with us. One of them is Schar V'Oinesh, which he calls Hanhagas HaMishpat. Hanhagas HaMishpat means Mida Keneged Mida, is if Klal Yisrael is righteous, then Klal Yisrael lives with the Beis HaMikdash in Eretz Yisrael. We live B'mailash, at the top of the world, because HaKadosh Baruch Hu looks down and rewards us. And Chas V'Shalom and Klal Yisrael is not doing Ritzon HaShalom. So then things do not work out that way. There is Din, there is Cheshbon, there is Schar, there is Oinesh, there is Midas HaMishpat in the world. And then the Ramchal presents something that's very deep. It's also very important. It's what I really want to speak about, what I want to develop a little bit about tonight. And that is, Ramchal writes that it's true. There is Schar, there's Onish. But there's another Hanhaga that the Kodesh Baruch Hu has. And that Hanhaga he calls the Hanhagas of Yichud. This world, so to speak, it's true, is in our hands. If we're good, so then we're rewarded. And if we're not good, is then we're not rewarded. Hashem Tzilcha, as the Baal Shem Tov used to say, HaKadosh Baruch Hu is almost like a shadow. It's responsive. If we are told HaKadosh Baruch Hu is good to us, if we are not told HaKadosh Baruch Hu is not good to us. Pasuk says by Avraham Avinu, V'yavarechecha v'varachecha v'yaorcha ataor. I will bless those that bless you, and those that curse you, I will curse. And in that way, it's responsive. That's Midas HaMishpat, but there's a limit to everything. And there's a limit to Midas HaMishpat as well. And that's because the Yichud HaKadosh Baruch Hu, HaKadosh Baruch Hu has a purpose in this world. HaKadosh Baruch Hu has a plan in this world. HaKadosh Baruch Hu has a tachlis in this world. And therefore HaKadosh Baruch Hu works out through his unbelievable means that anything and everything that takes place in this world beyond Din, the Cheshbon, and Tzchar, and Oynish has to bring the world to that ultimate tachlis and tikkun, that ultimate place where HaKadosh Baruch Hu wants this world to go. Let's give a mashal. Let's give a story to illustrate. Simple, just to make things easy. There was once a powerful king, a person who managed had everything, and he had one son who was the apple of his eye. But that son went from chayil al chayil in a derech that was lo tov. And as he developed, as he matured, he was not interested in the good and the wholesome and the wonderful things in life. And he took a bad course. And it ended up, there was once that he was mamash caught with a group of young men stealing. They were brought before the judge, and the case was going to be tomorrow, that next day, by night. The judge came to the king And he said, Your Royal Majesty, I mean, I know that you're aware that tomorrow in front of my court, your son is going to be brought to justice. What should I do? So the king was amazed. He came to ask. Justice is justice. My son is no exception. Is you should give to him what you give to the other young man, and you should punish him exactly as due his course for what he deserves. The shofet was amazed. This was what the king said. But he felt free. He felt that that's the case, that he can go ahead. And that next day in court, the sentence was 40 malchus, lashes, a year in prison for what they had done. No different. All the other boys, no different than the son of the king. And the son of the king was given lashes. And he was sent to prison for a year. At the end of the year, so all the boys were free. And unfortunately, as sometimes has happened in prisons, instead of being a place where people become better, they become worse. The son of the king was no exception. That year in prison did not do him well, and he came out and he went back to his old ways. He was caught again, but this time it was not robbery. This time the group of young men had murdered, and it was murder. The punishment for murder was much more. The judge realized that next day, tomorrow, he's going to sentence this young man. The sentencing is going to be a murder trial, and it's going to be an eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth. It's going to be his life. The judge remembered how he had previously gone to the king, and therefore he realized that he doesn't need to go again, because the king already told him, my son is no different than anyone else. Let it be then that tomorrow I'm going to go into the court, and I'm going to judge exactly like I would judge anyone else. The judge went to sleep that night, and at 3 o'clock in the morning, one of the king's messengers came and said the king would like to see him. The judge said, of course, and the judge went to see the king. The king said, I want one thing from you. I want you to spare my son's life. I want you to acquit my son tomorrow. And the judge had that look, being perplexed. And he said, Your Royal Highness, if that's what you're asking me to do, then that's what I'll do. I'll find a way. And so it was. He found a way, and he acquitted this young man who was the son of the prince, son of the king. But the judge could not contain himself. And so, soon after, he came to the king, and he asked, Your Royal Highness, it is not my place, but if you would allow me, please ask of you. A year ago, I came to you and I asked you, how should I treat your son? And your answer was, like everyone else. Exactly like everyone else. And then, three nights ago, you came to me and told me that my son is to be acquitted because he's the son of the king. Can you explain to me what changed in the duration of the year? And the king understood immediately what he was asking and said, of course, you deserve an answer. He said, my son grew up and I could see in him that he was becoming more and more rebellious. When he stole and when he was being brought in front of you for justice, so my hope was that he would experience those malchus, those lashes. He would be a year in prison and he would realize, lo zu aderech, this is not the way. He would improve and he would come back to me. That did not happen. The malchus didn't help, the lashes didn't help, the year in prison didn't help, and the king had a son who was even worse. The son went and the son was involved with murder. At this point though, what am I going to let you do? Kill him? He's my son. He's still my son. And that I cannot let you do. Will find a way, somehow, somewhere, sometime, he will get better, and he will go back to his rightful place. This illustrates the concept that there's mishpat. The world is filled with mishpat, and generally speaking, the world works with mishpat. But there are certain times, there are certain places after certain incidents that address the very tachlis of the world. And when they address the tachlis of the world, there are limitations placed on mishpat. There's such a thing as Yichud HaShem. And on Hagra of Yichud HaShem is the world works towards its ultimate tachlis. The Maral, I think, uses this similar type of concept in many places, and I want to develop it a little bit more. The Maral is found in Netzach Yisrael. It's Perek Aleph. And there the Maral quotes the question of the Rabbah. It's a beautiful question. It's a great question. It's a very hard question. In Parshas Noach, we are introduced to Noach. Noach is an Ish Tzaddik. He's a Tommy. He's wonderful. He's absolutely God. But before the Torah tells us that Noach was saved, he is Tamim Hayyabah Darasav Esa Lakimis Halak Noach. We're introduced to Noach. And therefore we understand why HaKadosh Baruch Hu is saving him from the Maral. In the beginning of Parshas Lech Lecha, the Torah tells us right away, Lech Lecha Me'artzecha, Hashem speaks to Avram. Not a word of introduction is given as to who is Avram. And even if Orkazim is mentioned at the end of Parshas Hanoyach, it's mentioned cloaked. It doesn't say anything overt in the Torah of any reason why Avram is special. It doesn't say one word. It says nothing. It doesn't say anything at all. Ask the Rabbah. It's strange. You're choosing Avram to be the father of Klal Yisrael. He's going to be the Amad Yivchar. Tell me why. Tell me who he is. Tell me something special about him. This is the Ramban's question. The Ramban gives an answer which the Maral finds weak. If the Torah would have spoken about Avram's greatness, it would have had to spiel about his interaction with Ovdei Avodah Zorah, which the Torah doesn't like to do. The Torah didn't want to speak about Ovdei Avodah Zorah. That's why the Torah didn't go into it. The Maral finds that answer weak. So the Maral says an amazing thing, and I'd like to put it into these terms. The Maral says there was a tremendous difference between Noach and between Avram. The Bechira of Noach was a Bechira Prati, he calls it. A Bechira Prati means it was Noach, the individual, was chosen. When I choose an individual because he's an individual, I'm choosing him because of the merit of his actions. So I have to speak about what he's done. It is in the Hanhaga of Mishpat. He has earned to be saved. The world is being destroyed because of Einshin, because of Averis. And there's one person in Mishpat who deserves to be saved. The Hanhaga of Noach is the Hanhaga of Schar Va'Onish. And when it's Schar Va'Onish, you have to explain to me, well, what is his merit? The Maral writes, very deep idea, but I think that it's able to be understood in these terms. The Bechira of Avram is not the individual. It is something is seen in this person to be the father of a nation that's going to be part of the greater plan of the world. He is going to be incorporated in the very fabric of the matara, of the goal of this creation. Behi baram ba'Avraham. It says, Behi ashas asem alokim, behi baram. HaKadosh Baruch Hu created the world. Behi baram means he created. It's the same letters of the word Avram. Avram is the tachlis of the creation. It's not just because at this moment he's good. And if he's not good, then Avram is going to lose his status. It's not true. Avram and his children forever after were placed into the very essence of the Bria, connecting them to HaKadosh Baruch Hu, regardless of their merit. If I would tell you that Avram has been chosen because of his wonderful kindness, and if he's not kind, and if he's no longer good, then he doesn't deserve to be in that place. Chas v'shalom. That's not the place that Klal Yisrael was given. And the place that Klal Yisrael was given was a place that regardless of any particular time, any particular moment, any particular maila or lack of maila that we may not have, Klal Yisrael became an Amad Nivchar that we're taken to be close to the Ribbono Shel Olam. And the Maral explains this with a Medrash. The Medrash says, who would it be that would come close to Hashem? Omar Rava Barav Munda. Maila Zu Yesh Ben Yisrael Goyim. There's a maila that Klal Yisrael has above the non-Jews. The evil of Yisrael Ksiv, when Hashem speaks about the Jewish nation, it's Vahayisi Lechem Le'Elokim. I will be to you as a God. The order is, I will be to you as a God, and you will be to me as a people, but you will be my people, I will be to you as a God first. The evil begoyim ksiv, me who zeh ove ves libo legeshes elai no'om Hashem, li yos li la'ah. First, you have to be deserving. And then I will reciprocate to be kind and goodly to you as a God. Now, the morale's understanding is that by the Klal Yisrael, it's an innate relationship. A ben, is not an employee that you fire. A ben is not an eved that you buy and you sell. A ben, a son is such that you give birth to him, and it's biological, it's innate, it's something natural. And if you can have many sons, then you are b'ni b'chayr Yisrael. You are my firstborn. You are here, b'chor is there's no other b'chor, it's only you. That is your place in my life. That is your place in my world. I have taken you to be my nation. And the morale continues. Very famous in this way, the Chazals that he uses, but his understanding, we were taken in this role because HaKadosh Baruch Hu brought the Torah down to this world. The Tachlis of the world, Bishvil Reishis, Bishvil Torah Shenikra Reishis, Bishvil Yisrael Shenikra Reishis. Klal Yisrael is linked to Hashem's Torah. We were brought close to him through that Torah, and we were made as part and parcel of the Matara of this world, to bring Torah down to this world. Writes the Maral, Kidereish Lakish, the Yom Reish Lakish, Maidich Si, by the Erev, by the Boker, Yom HaShishi, is Hey Yisera Lomali, by the other days, it doesn't mention HaChamishi, it says HaShishi, and the specificity is Melamed Shehisna, Kodesh Baruch Hu, Maisa Bereshis. Kodesh Baruch Hu made a condition of Maisa Bereshis. If Yisrael are Mekablin, the Torah, Atem, Miskayomim, then there's a world, because there's a purpose to the world. Klal Yisrael, when they receive the Torah, is united with that which is the purpose of the world, and therefore that place becomes Klal Yisrael's role. It's no longer only of how good we are and how not good we are. Kaviyochel, if you could use such words, like HaKadosh Baruch Hu needs us. He needs us to be the light unto the nations. He needs us to be that which is going to elevate the human race. And to understand him, to come close to him, to serve him properly. That is the place of Klal Yisrael. And without a Klal Yisrael, then what world, what is the world for? What purpose is the world going to serve? It loses its purpose. Writes the Maral, the very famous Medrash. Kadosh Baruch Hu is Kafal Leim Har Gigigis. They had said Nasa Vidishma already, but it's not enough. It's Kafal Leim Har Gigigis. The Maral's understanding is, because having the Torah is not by choice. You wanted and you said, Nasa v'nishma, you have to know. The world was created for the Jewish people to accept the Torah, and therefore, if you take it good, and if not, shum teik for us, and if not, then you're buried. This is the Das Tfunas' understanding. That there is schar and there is einish. There's a hanhaga of mishpat, but it has limitations. The limitations are that this world plays to a tachlis, and for the sake of that tachlis, is Klal Yisrael is necessary, and Klal Yisrael is part and parcel of the Etzem Bria itself. It's part of creation, just like Torah is part of this world's creation. It's the fabric of what the world was for. That's the Jewish nation. This has been said by the Beis Halevi. We've spoken about Avraham Avinu. The Beis Halevi speaks in terms of Yaakov Avinu. Yaakov Avinu is told that it's time to go down to Mitzrayim. The Pachat, to go to Golus and Mitzrayim. The Pasuk says, Al Teira, near the Mitzrayim, don't be afraid to go down to Mitzrayim. Keep L'goy Gadol HaSimenu Shom, I'm going to make you very great there. V'anochi Eren Imcha, I'm going to go down with you there. V'anochi Alcha Gan Allah, and I will come up also up when you come up. Says the Beis Halevi, very famous words. Not so long, I want to read a few words to you. It's very famous. Beis Halevi says, Dekan bo lo havtacha ha-gedor lo shebekol havtachas. This is the greatest promise. Yaakov is the Bechira Avos, he's the chosen of the Avos. He's about to go down to Golos. This is the climax of what Avram began. His climax in this havtacha being given to Yaakov Avinu. Sheyihye nikra shmo al Yisrael. The Shem Hashem Yisrael, the Shem Hashem is Chal al Klal Yisrael. And HaKavanah B'zeh, what that means is Dili Oilam La Yufalsim Shem Kvoda Bi Oilam. There will never be a piercing of the Shem Hashem through a miracle in anything else other than Yeshua Sam Shem Yisrael, other than to save Klal Yisrael. Klal Yisrael is the vehicle for Kvod Shemayim in this world. And when you go down, I go down with you. When Klal Yisrael is begolus, so then I'm begolus with you. And when you come up and you, so to speak, on the top of the world, then I will be on the top of the world. And when Klal Yisrael becomes part and parcel of the Kvod Shemayim, he quotes the Medrash says, it's like a key. You're afraid, so to speak. The key is going to get lost. So you attach a chain to it. Klal Yisrael is like a key. They represent Kvod Shemayim in the world. I'm afraid they'll get lost, so I attach myself to them. That means, whether or not we're deserving, whether we are not deserving, and there's schar and there's onus, and we have better times and we have worse times, and we know that, we've endured so much. But the yichud, that hanhog is a yichud of a Kodesh Baruch Hu, it requires, it demands, it commands that Klal Yisrael will never be destroyed, Klal Yisrael can never be destroyed, Klal Yisrael are the very essence of the fabric of this world, and that's the place that Klal Yisrael played. The Ori Cheskel, the Cheskel Levenstein, says this in almost like an amazing way to me. It's almost an amazing way he says it. It's very, very, very famous. It always bothers many before Shem. We experience so much through the Makos of Mitzrayim. What more does Kriyas Yamsuf add? After so much, beginning, Dams, Vadeya, Makos, Bechoros, yet there's like a grand finale by Kriyas Yamsuf. What more did Hashem have to show us? So the Ori Cheskel has a very interesting mahalach. It's based on the Medrash, which everyone knows Rashi really brings. Halolu of the Avodah Zorah, and the Halolu of the Avodah Zorah. So why are you saving the Jewish people? Is the Jewish people are just as the Egyptians. The Egyptians do Avodah Zorah. Is the Jews do Avodah Zorah? What makes them more deserving? There, in the Medrash, Kodesh Baruch Hu told the Kitshruk, the Midas Adin, to be quiet. My world, I'll do what I want, told to be quiet. So Rabbi Cheskel Levenstein has an interesting question. He says, there's a Gemara Shabbos that speaks about the Churban Abayis. And the Gemara over there has another story about a time when Klal Yisrael was in danger of being destroyed. Ole HaKadosh Baruch Hu LeGavriel, go make a mark on the heads of tzaddikim to make sure that they're saved. Whoever will be destroyed in the times of the destruction, but make sure you mark the tzaddikim and don't destroy them. Amar midas adin lefnei HaKadosh Baruch Hu, Ribono Shel Olam, man ishtanu eilu me'eilu, the same man ishtanu, man ishtanu eilu me'eilu. Amar lehu, halal tzaddikim and halal rishoyim. What do you mean man ishtanu? These are righteous, these are rishoyim. Amar the fun of the Midas Adin said, Ribono Shel Olam, Hayu biyodam limchos v'lo michu. They should have rebuked the generation, and they didn't. And they're not Sadiq and Gomorrah, because they're responsible for the generation. The Ribono Shel Olam answers back, Golui biyodua, but I know, if they would have rebuked, they would not have been listened to. Says the Midas Adin, but the Tzadikim didn't know that. And the tzaddikim, therefore, are held fully responsible. The Gemara goes on and speaks about the Churban. The tzaddikim were not saved. Asks Rabbi Cheskel Levenstein. Isn't that interesting? So why was it that at the times of Kriyas Yamsuf, the Midas Adin was told to be quiet? And here, time of Churban, the Midas Adin has to be answered. And if not, if there's no answer, so then the Midas Adin is going to be in the world. And Tzaddikim are going to be held responsible for the averas of the Rishoyim. Says Rabbi Cheskel, HaKadosh Baruch Hu, by Kriyas Yamsuf, wanted to show us something. He took us out of Mitzrayim. He did tremendous miracles for us. The whole Teva bowed, caved into his will. It showed us clearly there's no limitation, nothing can stop. Once we were to see clearly, nothing can stop HaKadosh Baruch Hu. Not even Schar V'Onesh and Mishpat. Not even if we're not deserving. because HaKadosh Baruch Hu can do whatever He chooses, whenever He chooses. The Gemara says, HaKadosh Baruch Hu is Barachim on whoever He chooses to have Rahmanas. That's part of the Midas HaYichud HaShem, and that is exactly what Kriyas Yamsuf showed us. We learned from Yetzias Mitzrayim, there's no gvul to the power of HaShem. We learned from Kriyas Yamsuf, even though Halolu Abdi Avodah Zorah, Halolu Abdi Zorah, if it's the Ratzon HaShem, there's nothing that can stop Him because His power is absolute and complete. Yichud HaShem means that even the gvulim, the normal gvulim that He set up in the world, is Schar Ba'onesh, and you have to be good, and Kodesh Baruch Hu can do as He wills, when He wills it. So that throughout history, in general, at the time of the Chorban, you have to answer the Midas HaDin. In general, it has to be that the Midas HaDin has an answer to be met. But this particular time is Midas HaYichud HaShem. And throughout history, the Midas HaMishpat is held in abeyance that will never completely destroy Klal Yisrael. It will always be that Klal Yisrael will have that remnant that's going to be saved, because the Midas of Yichud HaShem will never allow for there to be, at any time, a complete destruction of the Jewish people. To go back in review, Kadosh Baruch Hu has two anhagas. There is anhaga of Schar Ba'onesh, reward, punishment, right? Gan Eden, Gehenna, we know, we're familiar. But there's something underlying everything. And that underlying everything is that the world has a mahalach, and everything is going to lead to where HaKadosh Baruch Hu wants it to go to. And despite the fact that we may choose and have the bechira, but we should know, anything, everything is going to lead the world to where HaKadosh Baruch Hu wants it. Underlying, there is a sense of Yichud HaShem, that anything and everything that happens only can take place because it plays in tune to HaKadosh Baruch Hu's Yichud HaShem. Yes? And therefore, Klal Yisrael will never be destroyed. Klal Yisrael will always be eternal, because Klal Yisrael is part of that fabric of HaShem. When we said Na'aseh V'Nishmeh, HaKadosh Baruch Hu put the mountain over our heads. When Avram was chosen, when Yaakov Avinu received that promise, at these points in time, the Shem HaShem was chal upon Klal Yisrael, and Klal Yisrael was part of the Bria. To go back to where we started, the Pasha of Bilam, the Pasha of Balak, it's an amazing story. It's much different than everything else in the Torah. Anything else in the Torah, when the experiences of the Jewish nation that we had, we were aware of, in Mitzrayim, we davened to HaKadosh Baruch Hu that He should free us. Bilam and Balak, the Jewish people, are completely unaware of what's taking place. We are not participants. It is completely in the hands of the Ribbono Shel Olam. Bilam is the Mechashev. He is the person who's in control of the Kayach of Tumah, and he is the one who knows when a Kadosh Baruch Hu gets angry. Why does a Kadosh Baruch Hu get angry? That's the Midas HaMishpat of the world. There's a moment every day where a Kadosh Baruch Hu, so to speak, is down the world in Mishpat. That's the moment when a Kadosh Baruch Hu gets angry. It's a Midas HaDin, and he sees the world in Mishpat. Had a Kadosh Baruch Hu dealt with Klal Yisrael with Mishpat, so then there would be ain't street of power, there'd be nothing left of us, because Bilam's kayach of Tumah to manipulate the Midas HaMishpat was so great, and that he could destroy Klal Yisrael. Kadosh Baruch Hu did not get angry, because he transcends the Midas of Mishpat for the sake of the Jewish nation. And the Navi tells us, my people, Klal Yisrael, look and see what a Kadosh Baruch Hu did for you in the times of Bilam and Balak. Leman das Sidkas Hashem, you should understand the Sidkas of HaKadosh Baruch Hu, how close you are to Him, how dear you are to Him, how beloved you are to Him, how important you are to Him. And to understand, that's your role. Chaviv Adam Shadivra Betzela. Chaviv Yisrael Shadikra Banim Lamakam. Is Chavid Yisrael that we were given the Kli Chemda of HaKadosh Baruch Hu. This is the role that we have. That's what the Navi is telling us. That's the Tzidkas of HaShem. That He doesn't only have Mishpat towards us. And therefore, even if it's possible that we would receive terrible things, but there's there's a concept that we're close to a Kadosh Baruch Hu, and therefore he rises above Mishpat. I think that this is why it would be appropriate that Parshas Balak, Parshas Bilam, should be in Kriya Shema. Because Kriya Shema is the time that we're makabel upon ourselves. The oil malchus shemayim of the idea of the Yichud of Hashem. Hashem Echad. Hashem Echad means that there's nothing else, there's no kayak, there's nothing else. And there's nothing else, there's only the Ribbono Shel Olam. There's a very famous piece from the Nefesh HaChayu, where he speaks about a Gemara of Chulin and of Zion, of a Matronisa, a witch that wanted to curse the Bichanina. And she wanted to take the dirt under his feet. And it was effective, it was a curse, it would work. The Bichanina said to his students, let her. Ein ol milvado ksiv. So the Nefesh HaChayim speaks out. He wasn't relying upon his righteousness. Righteousness is mishpat. He was relying upon his understanding of Ein Od Malvado Ksiv. It's just Hashem. When you connect to Hashem, when you go back, transcend above, and the schar, the oinish, you transcend back to Hashem Echad. So then Rabbi Chanina felt nothing will hurt him, nothing will touch him, there's nothing that's going to happen to him. And this, so to speak, was the godless of Rabbi Chanina, to be able to connect to a Kadosh Baruch Hu as the Yachid, Echad, and Yuchad. That there's no Kayach, there's no other Kayach. It is very famously said in the name of the Brisker Rav as he was escaping from Europe in the beginning of the war years, that he focused on the Yichud of Hashem, and that was the Schus, that Mary, that he should be saved at a time when there was danger all around. The Brisker Rav said, focus solely on the Kodesh Baruch Hu. Is this then, is our understanding of Klal Yisrael in history? Oh, we're surrounded with enemies. We've always been surrounded by enemies. We're a se'echon among Shiva Zevi. Today, yesterday, 70 years ago, 1,000 years ago, this doesn't seem to change. We should always know, we should always have that emunah, and that complete emunah in a Kodesh Baruch Hu. There's schar and there's onesh. We have to do whatever we can possibly do to improve ourselves. We have to make it that we take our hands and make ourselves the best that we can possibly be. But we also have to have the understanding of the Jewish people. The Jewish people are eternal. And we are an Am Nitzri. We are an eternal people. And that is because we are in the fabric of the very Bria. We are the Tachlis of the world. And for that reason, HaKadosh Baruch Hu will never let us be destroyed. It's that, I think, is the lesson of Parshas Bilam, Parshas Balak. That is why I think it would be placed in Kriya Shema, it should be placed in Kriya Shema. It is important for us to focus. Leman das Sidkas Hashem. This was begun by Avraham Avinu. It was continued by Yaakov Avinu. It was solidified at the time of Yitzias Mitzrayim, Kriyas Yamsuf, the accepting of the Torah. And this has defined Jewish history. There have been innumerable pogroms. There have been holocausts. There have been such tragedies. As we know, through it all, HaKadosh Baruch Hu has seen to it that Klal Yisrael is still Klal Yisrael, continues to flourish, continues to blossom, and continues to proclaim the Yichud Hashem. Shema Yisrael, Hashem Elokeinu, Hashem Echad. That is the beginning of Klal Yisrael, that is the end of Klal Yisrael. We attach ourselves to HaKadosh Baruch Hu in a complete commitment, a complete knowledge that Ribbono Shel Olam, we know that whatever may happen, but everything is in your hands, and ultimately this world is going to play to its tachlis until Ad Bias Kol Tzedek, the Mashiach Tzedekeinu, will come. Yetz Hashem, thank you.